What we're going to talk about today is, for the most part, you're going to be saying, I've never heard this before. And my first thing is, don't feel bad, because until about 2009, I hadn't either. So this is new information. To give you a little bit of background, though, I retired early. It's what we all strive to do. I hated it and went back to school. And so I got my bachelor's in 2006, my master's in 2008, and my PhD in 2011. And I throw that out there simply because I want y'all to understand this is new information. This isn't something, I'm way too young, you know, to have been out of school that, you know, just kidding. but normally someone who just graduated, you know, in 2011, they'd be 30 years old or something. So this is something that we've done recently. East and West Florida, this is where it all begins for me. How many of you knew that East and West Florida comprised British colonies when the American Revolution broke out? Not very many, especially if you weren't raised down here or in somewhere where these regions take place. This is how my wife and I met. I was giving a talk at the base of the St. Augustine Lighthouse, and I said, now, inside what is now the borders of the continental United States, there were 15 British colonies. And his hand shoots up at the back of the crowd and goes, no, I'm from Boston. There were 13 colonies. What are these other two colonies you're talking about? And all I could think was, I'm being heckled at a free talk. Are you kidding me? And I said, well, I'll give you a hint. You're standing in one of them, and her jaw dropped. Because she had been taught up in New England that during the American Revolution, this was Spanish Florida. I said, don't feel bad. I'm from Oklahoma. I was taught that the only thing going on here during that time period is where the Seminoles were going to come from. You know, we were taught in other parts of the country that anything down here was remotely interesting, much less significant. Now, to give you an idea of where this information came from, I don't want you to think that this is just some conjecture that I've come up with or a premise or, you know, just like, wow, what if that happened kind of a thing. When I was at the University of Florida, I went over to the Special Collections Library to volunteer. And the curator, Jim Cusick, he said, well, it's all Florida history. Where would you like to get your hands dirty? And I thought, well, St. Augustine's my favorite place in the world, and I don't speak Spanish. So how about the British period? He got all excited. He said, you see those four filing cabinets over there? And there were four filing cabinets, four drawers tall. He said, in 1938, a California Berkeley professor by the name of Lockie, who was a native of Pensacola, was dying of cancer, and he knew it. And he wanted to pay homage to his home state. So he grabbed about 10 grad students from Cal and took them over to the British National Archives. And they literally photostated every scrap of paper they could find that had anything to do with East and West Florida during the British period. About 6,000 to 7,000 pages. He said, now, I don't know if you've ever read it. Have any of you ever read a photostat? Yeah. It's a negative. And it's a black sheet of paper, only this one had the 18th century froofy, you know, writing in white. Took me 8 months and 2 prescription changes to get through all of that. But he told me, he said, so Dr. Lockie collected all this information. The problem was he died before he could do anything with it. So he left it to his top student. The top student had no interest in the project whatsoever. So in 1943, he donated the whole collection to the University of Florida. And then Dr. Cusick looks at me and says, that's all we know. No one's ever read them. So if you'd like to try, that'd be great, you know. So I did. And all of a sudden, I'm finding that I'm reading troop movements that I'd never heard in, you know, being in regions where they weren't supposed to be yet. I'm reading letters from royal governors to generals in the field and generals who weren't supposed to be where they were yet. And things coming over from Parliament. And I'm reading about an American Revolution that I had never heard of before. So I got to thinking, okay, this map was actually published in 1776, shows East and West Florida fairly prominently. Let's go take a look at what maps of the American Revolution look like, because I've never seen one that included Florida before. So I did what anyone else does when they want to learn something at the highest possible level of education. I Googled it. And these are the stars. These are the these were the guys who made the Hall of Fame. This one, it doesn't even show Florida. That's okay. It doesn't show Savannah either. And according to this map, there were only 7 major battles in the American Revolution, and Fort Ticonderoga was one of them. And all I could think was, come on, Ethan Allen knocked on the door and a guy in his pajamas handed him the keys. I don't think that qualifies. This map, this one's sexier. It has is troop movements and ships going all over the place. And you can see here, once again, Savannah's on the board, East and West Florida on the board. Interesting, there's no troop movements in and out of Savannah. But it says here, war in the North, 1775 to 1776. War in the Middle Colonies, 76 to 77. War in the South, 1780 to 1781. So evidently, 1778 and 79 was halftime, or seventh inning stretch, and nothing happened during those years. Oh wait, except for that was when Savannah went through 2 major sieges. But we're not counting that for some reason on this map. The next one, this is probably one of the most familiar maps when you're looking at the proclamation line of 1763. Shows it dotting all the way up. This was the line that kept English settlers from going over into across the Appalachians into Indian lands. According to this map, this was all Western claims, even what was east of everything over in Nova Scotia. According to this, Quebec was inaccessible. East Florida was inaccessible because if you'll notice, it shows the proclamation running right up to the Atlantic, which means if someone from Georgia wanted to go to East Florida, it would have been illegal to make that journey. So this map doesn't work either. This one got me excited. See how the proclamation line comes this far and then dips around? So now it is legal to cross over into East Florida. And same thing, it includes Quebec. So you can get to Montreal and you can get to Quebec City. So this one actually makes sense. And then as I'm looking, I'm going, wait a minute, they misspelled Chickasaw. And that's not how you spell Shawnee, and that's really not how you spell Iroquois. So I looked at the map and realized it's in German. And according to this map in 1770, we were still Spanish Florida in East and West Florida during this time. So I got all excited for nothing. This one's just dumb. This one is like Picasso does the colonies. But once again, according to this map, during the American Revolution, East and West Florida were Spanish property. So I thought to myself, what map were the British looking at in 1775? So I went over to the British National Archives and I found one. This map, this is just a section of this map. It was published in 1781. The map that I took this picture from is 20 feet wide and 12 feet tall. And it was actually published, and in the legend it says it's written and drawn for Thomas Brown, Secretary of the Southern Indian Department. Now, Thomas Brown's an interesting character. He was the son of a fabulously wealthy shipping magnate out of Whitby. He was the great-grandson of Sir Isaac Newton. So he was highly connected politically, aristocratically, financially. He came over to Savannah in 1774 in September with 29 indentured servants and a 5,600-acre land grant just north of, about 30 miles north of Augusta. And the governor instantly made him the magistrate of the area. And when war broke out in 1775 there at Lexington and Concord, he let it be known all up and down the Savannah River, into 96 in South Carolina, down to Charleston, that he was a king's man. Well, on August 2nd of 1775, approximately 100 Sons of Liberty from Augusta showed up in Brown's front yard, demanding that he sign an oath of loyalty to the rebellion or suffer the consequences. And he said, how dare you come up to me and demand that, you know, in the name of liberty and independence, that I do this and completely negate my own freedom of free choice in the process. Well, about half of them felt bad about it. And according to about a dozen reports, they started to leave. The other half started to argue with him. Brown slips inside his house, comes out with 2 pistols and a sword strapped to his side. He was kind of like Daniel Day-Lewis in Last of the Mohicans and Errol Flynn in anything. And he comes out and starts blasting and starts to draw his sword, and somebody fractured his skull from behind with a rifle butt. They threw him on the back of a horse, led him into Augusta, 30 miles away, where they took him off the horse. They stripped him completely naked down to his boots, beat him savagely, tied him to a tree. They scalped him, depending on the report, either 3 or 4 times. Then they tarred and feathered him. Now, they don't know if he lost 3 toes when the tar collected in his boots or when they pulled the boots off and put hot brands to his feet. Then they threw him in the back of a cart and paraded him up and down the streets of Augusta. He survived. Part of the reason he survived is that the tar and feathering formed a cap over the scalpings that kept it from getting infected. He makes his way, after his recovery, he limps into St. Augustine in December of 1775. Now, Governor Tonon, at this point, he had been building kind of a private army called the East Florida Rangers here in St. Augustine. Bunch of tough, rugged, backcountry woodsmen from Georgia and the Carolinas, and about 160 to 180 Creek warriors. These guys knew how, they were like his special ops, you know, black ops kind of an operations group. They needed a leader. They needed someone that everyone would automatically look up to. And when Thomas Brown came to town, to say the least, he was in a bad mood. And Governor Tonon said, that's my guy. That's who we're going with. And we'll get into a little bit more about Brown, but just to kind of give you an idea of who was involved in what was going on down here. How many of you saw the movie The Usual Suspects? Yeah, okay, he was the Kaiser Soze. You know, everybody thinks of Bannister Tarleton, you know, and the reputation he had during the American Revolution. He committed one heinous act at King's Mountain, and he gained that for the entire war. Thomas Brown was the person that you were scared to death was rustling the bushes outside your window. And he was like I say, a fascinating character. Now, this map that was destined for him, what I found in looking at the war through this map is I realized I had to look at the war from a British perspective. Because when you look at the American Revolution the way we do, it's 13 colonies from New Hampshire down to Georgia, all neatly snuggled into one another. The British had to concern themselves with 33 colonies from Nova Scotia, stretching all the way down to Grenada. Half of those colonies were in the British West Indies. During the fighting in the American Revolution, throughout the entire war, 60% of the British military was stationed in the West Indies, not up here where the fighting was. Someone tell me why. It's one word.
Trade. Sugar.
Sugar. Trade is right, but sugar was the primary trade. Sugar was the crude oil of the day. Sugar is what afforded empire. John Adams, he had no delusions that we were going to win this war on the battlefield. In 1775, the British West Indies were about 5 years deep into an 8-year drought. And Adams wrote the royal governors a letter and said, if you don't join the rebellion, we're going to cut you off. Because the foodstuffs that fed them, the flax for clothing for the slave population, anything they got into the British West Indies for provisions came out of the North American colonies, primarily the southern colonies. And Adams said, if you don't join the rebellion, we're cutting you off. Because what he believed that we could do is deprive the slave population of the basic essentials of life, food and clothing, drive them into revolt, shut down the production of sugar, cripple the empire economically, and they'll be so glad to give us our independence that we can't take it in fast enough. That's what his approach was. So this is how important these colonies down here. Because when you read the British documents, one of the things you hear over and over again is, don't be distracted by this mere rebellion in the American colonies and lose a square inch of soil to the Spanish or Dutch or French in the West Indies. Now, when you measure the distance between Nova Scotia, the capital of Nova Scotia, and the capital of Grenada, the geographic center of the British Americas in 1775 was 2 miles north of the St. John's River in what's now Jacksonville. Now, I've read, because they made me, all these books on the American Revolution and by some of the most prolific historians on this topic that our country produces. And every one of them will tell you the same thing. They either don't discuss these in West Florida, or when they do, it's like, well, yes, okay, they were British, they didn't rebel, but they weren't significant. We had in St. Augustine the only pair of stone fortresses south of the Chesapeake Bay, and we were at the geographic epicenter of everything the British were looking to accomplish during this time. See, I've heard them referred to, like St. Augustine, is in the frontier lands and the shadow lands and the hinterlands and the Disneylands and anything that just removes it from any kind of significance. But the waterways, the sea, those weren't barriers. That's how you got places faster. These were the superhighways. That's why the rivers were so significant when the interior of the country was formed. And they had already experienced in 1765 when the stamp tax revolts occurred. The stamp tax revolts, there were riots by the Sons of Liberty in Nevis and St. Kitts down here in the Caribbean. This wasn't just a Boston and Philadelphia thing. So they understood that the rebellion was rolling, basically steamrolling down through the southern colonies. By September 12th, every southern colony, with the exception of East and West Florida, had fallen to the rebellion. And it was only 1775. They had a long way to go. They saw the Floridas as a barrier to sedition and rebellion going out into the Caribbean. They also saw St. Augustine with our forts here as a launching pad of reclaiming the American South. Because again, from reading the British documents, they had two objectives when war broke out. Don't lose any land in the Caribbean and reclaim the American South. That was priority number one and number two. Now, I'm like any other red-blooded American person. If George Washington didn't say it or sleep there, it didn't happen. So I went to the Washington papers at the Library of Congress, and I thought, well, what does he say about all of this? And penmanship was not his thing. But this letter was written from Cambridge, Massachusetts on December 18, 1775. And basically what it says is he's writing John Hancock, the president of the Continental Congress, says, yesterday we intercepted a packet of letters destined for Governor Tonon in St. Augustine. The British are stockpiling arms and munitions in the castle in barracks in St. Augustine. And he was asking for an army to invade East Florida. This is in December of 75. Okay, this was the first of 81 letters. At least that's the number I found. There may be more, but it's the first of 81 letters that Washington wrote either to his general staff or to the Continental Congress, citing St. Augustine as either a military concern or a military target. He authorized 5 invasions of East Florida. This one, he called for Congress to authorize state militias and make the arrangements for state militias to put together an army from Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia. Congress became so alarmed by this message that they said, we're going to get you your militia armies. We're also going to include regiments of Continental Regulars from North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia. This was no small army. We're not talking about a border skirmish between Georgia militia and East Florida Rangers. This was a massive troop movement. And it wasn't like Washington was bored and had nothing else going on. In December of 1775, he was about halfway to two-thirds of the way through a year-long siege of Boston. He had another army invading Canada, as he wrote. Now he's asking for another army, a large army, as far away from himself and the Canadian expedition as you can possibly get, opening up a third front. This was how important he saw this information and this threat to the southern colonies. Now I thought to myself, all right, I'm starting to see a pattern here. What were the British doing? Because if there's anything I've ever been told, it's that the British were not interested in the southern colonies until 1780, when Mel Gibson won the whole war by himself, you know, out of Charleston. And that there was never anything going on down here. As a matter of fact, the only reason the British came south in 1780 was because of the defeat at Saratoga. They had to, you know, make up for this debacle and everything. So I go to the British National Archives, and I find this letter. And I'm going to get over here and see if I can read it. It's dated December 6, 1775. It's to Major General Clinton or the officer appointed to command an expedition to the Southern Colonies. Major General Howe, having been informed by a dispatch from one of His Majesty's principal secretaries of state on the 22nd of October, and again, 1775, that it was His Majesty's intention that the 15th, 37th, 53rd, 54th, and 57th Regiments of Infantry, together with two companies of artillery, should embark at Cork, Ireland, about the 1st of December, in order to proceed upon an expedition for reducing to obedience the southern provinces of North America now in rebellion. Okay, guys, the South mattered. The southern colonies were of extreme importance long before 1780. And the British knew it. They had an all-out expedition planned, and the primary target was Savannah. They already had a safe haven in St. Augustine. The next point of attack was Savannah. Secure that corridor of loyalty, then Charleston, then the Wilmington's Cape Fear area, then Norfolk, then on into the Chesapeake, and again, I'm just telling you what the British National Archives have. They believed that you won the war by taking Virginia. Okay? Virginia was the most populated colony. It was the wealthiest colony. And let's face it, we had all those hotheads up in Boston. I understand that. But four of the first five presidents came out of Virginia. It was the political hot seat. And they believed if we take Virginia, we win the war and shut this thing down completely. And throughout the American Revolution, this was their plan of attack. In fact, I found a letter. There had already been this invasion that they had called for. There was a letter written on September 3rd of 1777 from Lord George Germain, who was the author of this letter here. He was basically Secretary of State of the American Colonies. He was the one running the war. And there's a letter from him to General Clinton authorizing him to proceed into the South a second time. So how could he have decided to, we need to go into the South because we lost at Saratoga, when he wrote the letter issuing the orders 6 months prior to the defeat at Saratoga? So the South was always crucial during the American Revolution. Now this is the invasion, what King called the expedition, the Southern Expedition. This is in our book, The 14th Colony, and this basically is going to show you what was supposed to happen and what really did happen. What was supposed to happen is these little dotted lines here. We had Clinton coming down with a fleet from New York, Cornwallis coming over from a fleet from Ireland, and in that fleet he was carrying 10,000 stands of arms. Now, I don't know about you all, but up to this point, I'd only heard of two things ever happening in the southern colonies prior to 1780. One was the skirmish between Patriot and Loyalist militia at Morse Creek Bridge, North Carolina, on February 27th of 76. And then I remember Clinton sailing in with a fleet into Charleston in the summer of 1776 and just getting spanked and sent back to New York. Other than that, nothing happened. Well, now we know that Clinton came down on purpose. Cornwallis was coming over from Ireland. Here's a guaranteed 10,000 Loyalist militia out of North Carolina. The deposed governor said, oh, I absolutely guarantee there won't be a man less than 10,000. But they need arms, and that's why Cornwallis is bringing 10,000 stands of arms. Thomas Brown had said, I can raise 4,000 backcountry woodsmen and about the same number of Native American warriors out here in the backcountry, and we'll take Augusta. Needless to say, he still had a little bit of a grudge against the city of Augusta. So these guys were all going to come down to the Cape Fear River right here. They were going to get their arms, they're going to recoup, and then go down and hit Savannah. In the meantime, while Brown's striking in the south, General Prevost is coming up out of St. Augustine with a 2,000-man army of British regulars, and they're going to pinch Savannah from this side. That's what was supposed to have happened. Clinton was supposed to arrive at the Cape Fear on March 1st of 76. He got there March 12th. It's the age of wind and sail. That's not too bad. In the meantime, the current superintendent of the Southern Indian District, John Stewart, originally he was really excited about this idea of this backcountry army because he saw his Native American warriors being involved, and this was going to bring him glory and everything back in London. And then all of a sudden it dawned on him, wait a minute, I've got this upstart 25-year-old Thomas Brown, who's actually going to be leading them, and he's so much better connected than I am, he's going to get all the glory. So Stuart sails up to the Cape Fear River. He gets there about March 15th, and he tells General Clinton, yeah, my Indians aren't coming. As a matter of fact, I am so determined that they're not going to help out. I have called a Congress down in Pensacola, and I've got all the headmen going the wrong direction. This is what you can do when your boss is in London. The distance is measured, you know, by the calendar rather than by the number of miles. You can pretty much do whatever you want and deal with the consequences later. So the backcountry army just lost half of its forces. The settlers are kind of looking at things like, you know, these Indians are pretty smart. They've been fighting in these woods a long time. If they're not showing up, what are we thinking? And they kind of melted into the woodwork. So we had Thomas Brown coming up here with a 20-horse team loaded with gunpowder and munitions and basically looking for an army that was never going to materialize. In the meantime, Cornwallis got blown out into the Atlantic by a hurricane. He had to regroup in Jamaica. He was supposed to be getting here around March 1st. He didn't show up until May 3rd. General Prevost comes up out of St. Augustine, hits the St. Mary's River, and remember that army that Washington called for? There they were, sitting strong on the Georgia side of the St. Mary's River. And what had happened was they had actually kind of gotten bored waiting for all this to happen. And the Georgia militia, all by themselves, beat the British back to the St. John's River and were holding the ground. The Continental Army never moved because what nobody understood was that these guys were so beat down with camp fever, they couldn't have crossed the St. Mary's River if they had wanted to. And they were just basically laying over in camp, dying 14, 15 men a day. The only reason that the British got the Georgia militia out of this wedge between the St. Mary's and the St. John's River is Thomas Brown had made his way back by this time. He sent some of his men up into the American camp and spread a rumor that Cherokee warriors were ravaging the backcountry of Georgia and all their homes were, about 2,000 warriors and all their homes and families were in danger. So these guys skedaddled and went back to Georgia to save their homes. And that's the only reason that that invasion actually fell apart. In the meantime, Cornwallis finally shows up at the Cape Fear, and General Clinton says, well, you know, these guys never made it down because it wasn't 10,000 Loyalist militia. There were 1,500. They barely had any arms between them. And they got intercepted by a group of 1,000 Patriot militia. Guess where? Morse Creek Bridge. They knew they were coming. They didn't stumble onto to each other. They had heard about all this. The spies and espionage going on at this time was prolific. And they cut them off. So now we have Cornwallis showing up, we have Clinton showing up, and that's it. And Clinton said, well, you know, it's all about glory on the battlefield and glory back home. So forget Savannah. Charleston's clearly the biggest pearl in the jewel. Let's go there. And they go into Charleston, and they were waiting for him. And that's what happened to the Southern Expedition. It wasn't that the British didn't intend it. It wasn't that this wasn't significant down here. It was so poorly orchestrated that it was never seen by modern historians as a full-fledged coordinated invasion. But that's what happened. Now, In the first invasion of East Florida in 1776, this is that battle I was telling you about where they came down and here's the St. Mary's, these guys are laid up, the Georgia militia makes it down here, get beaten back. That was the first invasion that Washington called for that took place in 1776. In 1777, he called for another invasion. This time they're going to come down and land at Amelia Island. The Continental Regulars this way. Once again, the backcountry militia came down out of Georgia. And these guys brought the wrong boats. They couldn't get across the Amelia River because their boats had too deep of a draft. They were stuck. And literally now they were in conflict with loyalists here on Amelia Island and end up just having to go back home. The militia came down, got turned by Thomas Brown at the St. John's River. In the meantime, Colonel Mark Prevost, General Prevost's brother, had made an end around, was waiting for them at the Battle of Thomas Creek Bridge. This is the southernmost land battle in the American Revolution. And they absolutely annihilated them at this battle. in early 1778. Washington called for another invasion, and this one got as far as the St. Mary's River. Here it had Fort Tonon, where the British were holed up, and the regulars and under General Howe and the militia under General Houston got in this big argument. Howe wanted to take Fort Tonon before proceeding to St. Augustine because he didn't want to have the enemy at his back. Houston said, forget Fort Tonon, let's just go on down to St. Augustine. So they argued bitterly. And Houston finally said, fine, go do what you want. We're sitting here and we're not going to play. And so Howe took his Continental regulars as they're crossing the St. Mary's River. Who's there? Thomas Brown. He and his East Florida Rangers. They set Fort Tonon on fire and make this hell-bent for leather ride, fleeing for their lives. You know, 17-mile ride with the advanced cavalry of Howe's army under Lieutenant Colonel Screven chasing them. And what happens is he leads them right into an ambush at Alligator Creek Bridge, where Mark Prevost had his cannon set up on the bridge and just waiting for him. And again, it was complete annihilation. Later in 1775 or 78, in the fall, word got out through espionage that the British are staging on Long Island for another shot at the South. And the question became, can we get our armies into St. Augustine and capture St. Augustine before the British can come up out of St. Augustine and take Savannah? General Rochambeau finally convinced General Washington that we can't do it. We don't have the time. Let's pull back our troops and defend Savannah. So what happened? A fleet comes down from New York. Prevost comes up from St. Augustine, and Savannah falls in December of 1778. And it was the only time in the American Revolution that the British reclaimed a fallen colony. Later in 1779, you remember this was the halftime, you know, that one map said nothing was going on. The Americans put together between them and the French a 10,000-man army. The British under Prevost in Savannah had a 3,000-man army to defend it, and they couldn't take it. They couldn't take it. And matter of fact, I found a letter from King George III to Lord North, who was the Prime Minister of Great Britain at the time. He said, if Savannah falls, forget Charleston. So again, reemphasizing that in their way of looking at the war, Savannah was more crucial, because that way you had that safe corridor at your back. And so if Savannah falls, forget Charleston. Well, Savannah held. And then that took place. So then in 1779, Washington calls for another invasion of East Florida. Once again, General Rochambeau says, we've gotten word that the British are now going to strike out of Savannah and come down from New York again, and now the target is Charleston. And I think we need to take those troops and pull them back instead of trying to take East Florida, pull them back and protect Charleston, which is exactly what they did, and you know the rest. In 1780, in March of that year, Charleston falls. The reason I like to go into this much detail on these invasions, not just because they took place in Florida, but is to remind you that a major invasion of the southern colonies, five invasions of East Florida, were all called and authorized prior to 1780, when we're told that this area of the country had any remote interest to anybody on either side. So we now have a new American, now it doesn't change things. You have a new American Revolution in the South, okay? We still win, you know? Our founding fathers are still our founding fathers. Nothing changes. What we've done is we now have some more pieces to put into the puzzle. And that's what history and studying history is all about, and researching history. When you get back beyond a certain time frame, and I think of it when you get back before the Civil War, because the Civil War was the first time any kind of technology actually gave us a clearer picture, and that was with the photographs that were taken. You get back beyond that, the only thing we know about history is what gets dug up from the ground or brought up from the ocean or found in Great Aunt Lucille's bureau in the attic, you know, in some letter or something like that. Or in the case where I found these things, they were exactly where they were supposed to be. They were in national archives and special collections libraries. We just don't know to go look for them there because we have been listening to what the traditional story is. And so we have some more pieces in the puzzle that we can put in. And our goal right now is kind of grassroots. It's to get this information to folks like you, because I was working on my manuscript, pulling my hair out. If you ever dealt with academic editorial committees, it's I'd rather go to the dentist with no Novocaine. And my wife said, you know, every semester you wrestle with those people and nothing happens, another group of kids goes through the Florida school system and they don't know history that they're entitled to know. History, I mean, the American Revolution can be made relevant for the first time in Florida schools, and that's never been anything. And you talk to the school teachers and they're like, oh my gosh, this gives me something more to talk about than the Declaration of Independence in Yorktown. This makes these kids look at it and go, oh wow, that's cool. That happened here? Kind of a thing. And that's what our focus is with our books. Now, the quick question is, how many of you can remember everything I just told you? The first question I used to get after every talk is, when's the book coming out? When's the book coming out? You know, because you can't remember all of this. And so that's, again, that's why we decided to do it this way. This is our first book in the series, and this basically gives you the story that you got this morning. Our second book of the series, Hope of Freedom, Southern Blacks and the American Revolution. When you find 5 years of missing military history, you find 5 years of missing African American history, 5 years of missing Native American history, women's history. This is how the series is going to progress. And during the American Revolution, slaves were offered their freedom by the British. If you just run away and fight for us, we'll give you your freedom. Well, that was great, unless your owner was someone who supported the rebellion. You know, if they were, that was great. If your owner was a loyalist, forget it. We're going to beat you half to death and send you back in chains. This was the facade of this freedom offered to them was monumental. And between 12 and 13,000 of these folks found their way to East Florida by the end of the American Revolution. And the story is powerful. The will of the human spirit to survive and to prevail. Our third book coming out. It's in production right now. It's been laid out. Women of the American Revolution, Lost Voices of America's First Generation. This one, women's stories have been left out of the American Revolution from day one. And these are not your Betsy Ross stories, okay? These are about women from all 15 colonies, every color, every status of free or enslaved. And they may have been known in their little region of their county or something like that, but these are stories that they need to be told, and kids need to know this information nationwide. I mean, we had one lady out of Massachusetts who, she didn't want to just serve the country, in what that would be considered back then a normal way. She wanted to fight. She was about 6 foot tall. I've seen her portrait. She was not a handsome lady. And she disguised herself as a man and enlisted in the Massachusetts military in the regiment. And she was involved in hand-to-hand combat. She went into the hospital after one battle with a saber wound to the head and a bullet wound to the upper thigh. And she woke up, found her head bandaged, but they hadn't seen the wound in her thigh. And she pretty much figured out, once they pull my drawers down, the jig is up. So she limped off back to her tent, dug the bullet out with her own knife and sewed herself up. And I thought, why would she put herself through this to keep from being discovered? And then I found a story of another lady in Massachusetts who'd done the same thing, but after being promoted to corporal, someone found out that she was indeed a woman. She deserted, and they found her, they arrested her, sentenced her to 2 years in prison, not for desertion, for wearing men's clothing in public. And that's what but they were willing to do that. They were willing to do whatever it took. And when the battlefields ended up in your front yard in some of these regions of the country, the stories of courage that and things these women endured is unbelievable. My favorite, and I'll share this and then we'll call it a day, the governor of Georgia, when Savannah fell, Stephen Hurd, he made his escape, fought with Georgia militia, was captured at the Battle of Kettle Creek, was taken up to Augusta and was going to be executed. the woman and her husband, who were his house servants, his slaves. It was Mammy Kate and Daddy Jack were the names that history has recorded them by. She went to that prison with a big basket, and she said, "I will not allow this man to spend his last night on earth sleeping in dirty clothes and dirty linens." And they said, "Go ahead." So she went in there with this big pile of clothing and linens and things, dumped most of it out, put the governor in the basket, because evidently he wasn't that big of a man, covered him up and walked out like nobody's business. Got into the woods, and Daddy Jack threw him up on a horse, and they took off with him. And their graves are now in a place of honor there in the state of Georgia. I mean, these are the kind of stories that I've just got goosebumps again. Every time it happens, it never fails. There are two things that we're going to ask of you today. Number one, if you know anyone who's an educator, I don't care if they work in the school lunch program, if they're the superintendent of the county schools, if you know anyone in the education field, homeschool, private school, public school, please get our web address. It's on the back of the maps. It's on by the logo on the front of the map. Get them our web information. We have a link on our menu page just for educators. We've hired a teacher to identify vocabulary words and words in context and challenge words. So the teachers have free teaching tools. We've put together word search games and things like that so that the teachers can have this additional information for free. And we want them to be able to utilize this information in the schools. Because I've come to the conclusion long time ago, I don't have that gene. Whatever that gene is for getting up in front of a bunch of kids, I love talking to adults. And I like teaching the teachers, because I feel like if I've talked to 50 teachers, I've talked to, 200 classrooms. But when I decided to go back to school, my daughter said, "Well, that's great. What are you going to major in?" I said, "History." And she's like, "So what, are you going to teach high school?" And I said, "Honey, I didn't like you when you were in high school." No, no interest whatsoever. The second thing that we're going to ask of you is try and buy a book. We are not a 501c3. We don't get grants for this. We're producing these out of our pocket. And that's how much this means to us. And we produce book two because we sold enough of book one. And we make them available here at these talks. They're $5 a piece. And this is what keeps the ball rolling. This is a grassroots movement. I can't afford a politician in Tallahassee. So the way we're getting this information out there and into the schools is not through the school systems themselves. It's by getting to get in front of teachers. And when we can be an in-service speaker to one of the school systems, then we can start making the gains that we hope to make.